Man, woman, birth, death, infinity.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the Your Health radio and television program on the radio at AM 1240 KNRY, AMP Cable Television Channel 24, and on the web at www.ampmedia.org. Join our rotating host and their informative guests live every Monday afternoon at 4 o'clock. The purpose of the Your Health radio and television program is to help get, make, and keep listeners and viewers like you healthy. And now, ladies and gentlemen, on with the program.
Welcome back to Your Health radio and television program. I'm Dr. David Morwood. I am a board-certified plastic surgeon, and I'm so delighted you could join us today. My first guest, Dr. Patrick Feehan, radiation oncologist. Dr. Feehan, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me.
Dr. Feehan, let's start out by teaching our audience, whether they're listening or viewing, about radiation oncology. Now, can you define what a radiation oncologist is?
A radiation oncologist is separate from a medical oncologist who administers chemotherapy and treats with hormonal therapy. Radiation oncologist uses radiation specifically to treat cancer. That's what we do.
Well, when you talk about using radiation to treat cancer, you know, for any of us around during the 60s or the 70s, we learned that radiation was harmful.
Right.
But now if we fast forward 30 years later, then we find that radiation is being used to actually treat cancer or kill cancer cells. Now, how's that work?
Yeah, now radiation is your friend, right? That's the way we're working, yeah. Radiation for cancer cells works specifically in a very fast-growing cell. So if you think of the human body as constantly being radiated. We're being radiated as we sit here. We're being radiated when we fly in an airplane. So your body's very good at repairing the damage done by radiation. The cancer cell, on the other hand, is growing really rapidly, so when you irradiate it, the DNA is fractured, and that DNA doesn't have time to heal the damage, nor the capability to do it. So we're very good at specifically targeting tumors that are localized.
Well, Dr. Feehan, let's distinguish between a benign tumor and a potentially malignant tumor or cancer. Now, you use that term tumor, mm-hmm. which essentially in Latin is lump or mass. Mm-hmm. So how do we distinguish between a benign lump, benign tumor, and one that's potentially malignant or cancerous?
A malignant tumor, anything that's an abnormal growth is a tumor, that's correct. A malignant tumor is something that has broken through the basement membrane. And when it breaks through the basement membrane, it's able to spread to other sites, either by the bloodstream or by lymphatics. It takes a specific chemical composition or different hormones to allow the cancer cell to actually break through the basement membrane. But that's what distinguishes benign from malignant.
Well, let's take a very simple example. As a plastic surgeon, I'll oftentimes see a patient with a tumor, let's say a lipoma, mm-hmm. which is a benign fatty tumor, mm-hmm. and we're asked to remove the tumor to try to minimize the scar and minimize damage to any surrounding structures, et cetera. And then there's something called a liposarcoma,
right.
which is actually a fatty tumor that is potentially malignant.
Right.
So is it on the cellular level that there's a difference between a benign tumor like a lipoma and a potentially malignant tumor like a liposarcoma?
Yeah, certainly at the cellular level. What's happening with that lipoma is it's growing and growing and growing more rapidly than the average cells, but it's not able to leave that little area that contains it. It hasn't broken the basement membrane, so it can't spread. In the case of a liposarcoma, it can break through the basement membrane, it can attach itself to the bloodstream, and then the next place it's probably going to show up is in the lungs. So the tumor has gone from one site to another in other words, it's metastasized to another site. So.
Okay, so certainly whenever someone has a lump or tumor, mm-hmm. it doesn't mean it's malignant, it doesn't mean it's cancerous, and it needs potentially a biopsy and a workup to distinguish what it is or determine what it is.
Correct.
So before we get into more of the details about how you treat cancer with radiation, let's talk about how you got to be a radiation oncologist. Now, I know that you have been chief or medical director of the department here at Community Hospital in Monterey. Mm-hmm. You're now on the staff there, Community mm-hmm. Hospital Monterey, as a radiation oncologist. But in the past, you were a trained internal medicine doctor. You were an internist.
Right, right.
So tell us about the training period and the how you got to be an internist and then went on to radiation oncology.
Yeah, the training is extensive, obviously, as you did yourself. 4 years of medical school, followed by my path, I took a year of flexible internship. Then I did 3 years of internal medicine to become board certified in internal medicine. Practiced internal medicine for a period of time, and then my daughter was born, and I realized those 100-hour weeks weren't going to work well. I was interested in cancer, so I went back for a second residency at UCSF, which was radiation oncology, which again was another 3 years plus oral boards.
So it's a whole additional 3 years of training.
Right.
And you were a trained internist and were in practice.
Yes.
And I think that's important to emphasize, that a lot of specialists, whether they're in medicine or surgery, have already become trained in another specialty, like internal medicine, and you went on to additional training.
Now we all sort of migrate, don't we, here and there.
So tell me kind of what spawned your interest in treating cancer. Why is it that you developed this fascination with cancer?
Yeah, I was practicing internal medicine in Mountain Home, Idaho, a small town, and about 15,000. There was one of two internists, so we were constantly busy. One of the things I noticed about my internal medicine practice is people didn't really want to get well. They had a hard time stopping smoking, they had a hard time controlling their weight, they had a hard time exercising, had a hard time remembering their medications. But whenever I had a patient that was diagnosed with cancer, suddenly I had a partner in this fight. We were going to beat this tumor, whatever it might be, this cancer, whatever it might be. And that was far more compelling than working with someone who wasn't really interested in caring for themselves.
So. I see. Well, I know, Dr. Feehan, you're very good at your job, and I appreciate you coming on the program, and your willingness to teach the public about what you do, I think, is really laudable. So let's get back to some of the details, and if we can, touch on the physics of radiation treatment toward a cancer cell. Now, you mentioned something about DNA. So it sounds like the DNA inside a cancer cell is going haywire. Isn't that true?
Right, and the cancer cell can be duplicating itself every 25, 26 days. Average cells, what, 100 days, 120 days. So they're growing really rapidly. And what happens with the cancer is it grows so big in a confined space, or splits off and grows so big in, say, liver or lung or brain, that it squeezes off the good organisms and eventually kills it. It's just a real rapid reproduction of cells. The way the radiation kills those cancer cells is you'll have a photon beam that comes into the cell. It'll split off a hydrogen off of a water molecule, so now you have a hydroxyl, which is a free radical. This free radical in proximity to the DNA splits the DNA open, and the cell hopefully is going through the cell cycle, and with a split DNA is unable to code for a cell that's going to be the same. It's unable to code for a cancer cell, so it dies. So it's what we call an inner mitotic death that's caused by the radiation. It's being caused by split DNA during the reproductive cycle.
Well, Dr. Feehan, you know, I love these segments where I get to learn a lot. Now, I just want to review that again for not only my benefit, but for our viewers and listeners. So it sounds like the chromosome and the DNA in a cancer cell is rapidly proliferating.
Correct.
And reproducing itself, and somehow the radiation comes in and disrupts that, kind of splits the chromosome or makes the DNA inoperable. Is that true?
It makes the DNA so it codes for a false self. So when it goes through the cell cycle, instead of breaking off and having a cancer cell, it breaks off and has a cell that's not going to survive. So,
okay. So then the next question I have, what immediately comes to mind, is how do you get the radiation to the cancer?
That's a good question. And there's lots of different ways. Most commonly used in the United States right now is called a linear accelerator. And what we do is we actually accelerate in this waveguide electrons to close to the speed of sound, ram them into a target, and we create photons. The photons have an energy of anywhere from 4 to 18 million electron volts, huge amount of electricity, that we can guide, specifically shape it in any way we want to shape it, and shoot it right into the tumor.
Well, that's amazing. Dr. Feehan, most of the audience by now knows that I'm a practicing plastic and reconstructive surgeon, and I'm involved in cancer a lot, as well as cosmetic surgery. And I'm lucky enough to work with your department quite a bit. Now, why is it that the surgeon can be involved with the treatment of a cancer, and the medical oncologist, and the radiation oncologist?
Right.
Why is it that, for example, just an operation to remove the cancer is not enough?
And that's difficult, and that's often confusing to a patient. If we start out with breast cancer, because you're going to have Nancy here later, good one to talk about. Breast cancer is initially probably going to be picked up by a family practitioner who sends a woman for a mammogram. So we have suddenly another doctor involved, the mammographer. The biopsy will be performed there. That patient will be moved along to a surgeon who will perform a lumpectomy or a partial mastectomy or a mastectomy, some sort of surgery to remove the tumor from the breast. Then there's two options that happen. One of them is a medical oncologist who administers chemotherapy, and not all patients need chemotherapy. And the other one is the radiation oncologist who would irradiate either the intact breast or for residual tumor. Not all patients get to meet the radiation oncologist. They're two completely separate disciplines that treat patients in completely different ways.
Now that reminds me, of course, of a very important point, that in the minds of some patients, they confuse radiologist mm-hmm. with radiation oncologist.
Right.
We work together,
right.
and you work with the radiologist, but they're two separate specialties. Can you explain that for a moment?
Radiologists simply read x-rays, and they can be invasive. They can put needles into tumors or do all sorts of things with vascularity. Using x-rays to help guide them. Radiation oncologists, on the other hand, are simply treating cancer using radiation.
Okay, so I think that's important for the public to distinguish.
Completely different.
Well, Dr. Feehan, can you give us some examples of cancers and malignant tumors that are very suitable or very susceptible to radiation treatment? Like, give us some examples of what some of your favorite tumors to treat are, and those that you feel you can dramatically help people.
Right, favorite's a bad word, because it's never something you want to see. But tumors that, in my practice, which I see a lot of, are breast cancers. I see about 60% breast cancers. The patients we see in radiation, roughly 92% of them are going to cure. It's a fairly high percentage, which is pretty amazing and pretty gratifying, I guess. We see a lot of lung cancers, we see a lot of esophageal cancers, rectal, anal cancers, a lot of prostate cancer. About 60% of all cancers diagnosed in the United States are going to be treated at some point in time with radiation. We also see a number of brain tumors that we can approach with radiosurgery. We have a number of different modalities for prostate cancer, including radioactive seed implantations, IMRT, radiation therapy. We have a whole plethora of different modalities that are in our quiver in the radiation department.
Well, that you lead me to another interesting question, is that there are other ways besides the external beam that you can deliver radiation to a tumor. Isn't that right?
That's correct, yes.
You mentioned seeds, and I have worked with the radiation oncologist treating extremity sarcomas before, and I know they'll come into the operating room sometimes and implant the beads, the radioactivity.
Right.
So tell us about that. There are different ways that you deliver radiation.
Right. Brachytherapy is a form of placing the radiation right in the tumor bed. In the case of prostate cancer, it's an excellent form of therapy in which 25 or 30 catheters are going to be placed right into the prostatic tumor. It's a one-day procedure. 90% of the time, the prostatic tumor is going to be cured, which is that single one fraction. We certainly do that at the community hospital. Brachytherapy is often used for sarcomas. The tumor's taken out, the field, the bed is lined with radioactive catheters. We're brought back and we load them up later. GYN tumors frequently used after loading devices, in which a device will be placed in the vaginal canal and radiation will be placed right at the site where the tumor was, which gives you a much higher control rate.
I see. Now let's give a summary to our audience about kind of the mechanics and schedule of radiation treatment. Let's say someone has a breast cancer mm-hmm. and they have their mastectomy or they have a lumpectomy mm-hmm. and they're scheduled for 30 radiation treatments or 20 or 15. Let's just give a summary of what the mechanics is like. They come in every day, is it outpatient, do they get
sure.
an anesthesia? Are they standing up when they get the treatment?
No,
I mean,
no.
How's it work?
And quite often, if someone comes after breast cancer, they've had chemotherapy, so you know we're sort of a kinder, gentler form of treatment after the chemo. The first day is a consultation with the physician. After that, if the patient's appropriate for radiation therapy, they're brought in. A simulation is performed in which a simulation technician shoots a number of x-rays of the patient laying on a table, places little teeny dots, which are tattoos, which are permanent. And the reason we place those tattoos is to line the patient up in our laser beams. We have about 2 millimeters, about a 1/16 of an inch tolerance. We'll never miss by more than that in any given time. The patient is then sent upstairs for a 3D or 4D CT scan, or sent across the hall for a PET scan, which are fiber optically fed into our computers. And then the real fun part starts. We actually reconstruct those patients in 3 dimensions. We rebuild them, including all their vital organs. If it's a breast, it's the lung is in there, the heart, the spinal cord, the neck, the thyroid. Everything is placed within, or is identified within, this 3D conformal field. And then beams are set up in order to treat this patient specifically. It takes about a week. When we really start treating the patient, it's about 15 minutes a day. 5 days a week. Cancer doesn't grow on weekends and holidays, so we get a break. There are virtually no side effects for the first 3 weeks. And then in the case of a breast cancer, we'll see a little bit of skin redness quite often, possibly a little bit of fatigue. No hair loss, no nausea or vomiting. It's just a little bit of skin redness and fatigue is what we expect.
So in general, how many, this is an outpatient procedure.
Right.
They don't get an anesthetic.
Yeah.
They come in and have a treatment. And how long are they in your division or department?
They're in our department forever, it seems like. And for breast cancer, typically it's 33 treatments. For a prostate cancer, if they don't do seed implantation, it'll be 40 treatments.
So excuse me for interrupting, but is that 8 hours in a day, 33 times, or is that half an hour in a day?
At our center, we're pretty lucky. Right upstairs, we have valet parking, so they get out of the car. Right next to it is the coffee mobile, so they grab a cup of coffee, come downstairs, and then they'll be in our department for about 7 or 8 minutes.
7 or 8 minutes, and that's a treatment.
Right. Yeah.
And then they can ride home and rest and rejuvenate, et cetera.
Ride home, rest and rejuvenate, and again, generally don't have very many side effects. If they have fatigue, it's going to be worse Thursday, Friday, Saturday, better Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. The 2-day break gives them a little bit of help. We have nurses, 2 nurses on staff all every day, which are going to work with any skin problems they might have. We have a nutritionist in case we're treating a head and neck cancer and they have difficulty swallowing, that will help them get enough nutrition in. We have, at our center, we have live music at least 1 day a week. We have massage therapists to do neck and hands. It's
wow.
Sort of like going to Nordstrom's.
Excellent. Well, Dr. Feehan, we only have a few seconds. If someone has a question or wants or desires more information about radiation oncology, I know that the Community Hospital of Monterey has a lecture series, or can they call the division and get information? Do you have pamphlets? Is there information available on the internet? How does one find out more about radiation?
Well, we not only have lecture series, we have, certainly they can call our department. They're welcome to get a tour. We have a library within the department. They can come get all the pamphlets and information they want.
Excellent.
And more than willing to talk with anyone.
So that's the Radiation Oncology Department right here at Community Hospital in Monterey. You're a staff radiation oncologist there, Dr. Patrick Feehan. I certainly appreciate you coming on board.
David,
I know
thank you.
How hard you work for your patients and how meticulous you are. Certainly appreciate you coming on. I hope you come on the program again.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks for being here.
Thanks.
I'm Dr. David Morwood, and this is Your Health radio and television program. I'm a board-certified plastic surgeon, and we hope you stay with us. We're coming right back after a very brief pause for a very good cause.